and I wanted to welcome you to our 100th anniversary symposium. My name is Stephanie Pryor, the current president of the Arlington County Civic Federation, and I wanted to also say thank you for your involvement in our civic associations and our many other volunteer organizations, such as OAR, Arlington for Clean Environment, and many more organizations, being active citizens in our 100 years of amazing community leadership. But tonight, we're looking at the next 100 years. No one knows what it'll bring, or what we have, or what we'll do today to make our successors giggle. Tiny TV screens from the 1950s and 60s. Wait, we've got even smaller screens now, although they fit in our pocket, and people are watching TV on them. Our skinny ties that men wear. But those are back in style, too. And even we saw a few bell bottoms, Mr. Pelton. Those are back in style. And what never goes out of style, even temporarily or for long term or needs updating? Amazing people and volunteers who care about our community. An old saying is that we plant trees for our future. Today we planted just one, with many more coming this fall. So I wanted you to look around your community, help to grow and inform our next crop of volunteers who will continue to provide shade, sustenance, and many other benefits to many others, many of whom we don't even realize how much work many of us put in day to day or week to week. Help teach and expand the canopy of people who understand our community. I know later this evening we'll be talking about one of them in particular. People who know our neighbors and make this such an amazing community. And I realize tonight we don't have quite as many as we expected, because we do have a little bit of competition. Unfortunately, this evening, Ms. Garvey was not able to join us because of another county board event. We also have the Fire Station Number 8 event going on. Ms. Terry Perrell is actually up there right now representing us. As well as we have quite a few events. The book, who knew that the book sale would be so popular? I knew it was popular, but wow. But we're trying to be car-free here, so we had to do some carpooling, I know. So I wanted to definitely say thank you and enjoy the event tonight. And I did want to also say we do have both the proclamation from the governor's office up here if anybody would like to read this. It's also in our community booklet that many are in many of the chairs out, as well as the large with the state of Senate of Virginia also had a proclamation as well. Unfortunately, Senator Eben was not able to make it, correct? Okay, he had another meeting that happened. So without further ado, I wanted to go ahead and bring Mr. Pelton back up. We're going to be presenting a couple of the awards for many of our organizations this evening. Thank you.
So here you go. We have a budget.
Yay!
It just took a little longer to get there than I thought. I think what I want to say, which is not in here really, is that I have been watching the Civic. I've been, you know, in public office now for 20 years. And I've been watching the Civic Federation. And it's been an interesting organization. It's really been going through some changes, and I sense a real resurgence in what's going on, and I think that's due to some of the leadership and the folks here, and I feel it's getting re-energized. And the model of the Civic Federation is just so important for so many things that we do. Bringing, you know, it's kind of a pyramid, right? You've got the civic associations, and then you come together, and everybody has a way of reaching out. It's just a great way of distributing information, helping out with emergency preparedness, helping out with a lot of decisions that we make. So thank you for what you do. I feel like you're at a very good point for the 100 years, and it's gonna be exciting as you move forward. And then I have a proclamation, and I must tell you, part of the fun of being chair is reading proclamations. Is it? Is in the program, so I don't even get to read it. Well, that's all right, I won't. I think I will say, whereas, the Arlington County Civic Federation established in April 1916 as the civic voice of Arlington by a coalition of 6 local civic associations is the oldest countywide organization in Arlington. The oldest countywide organization in Arlington. And boy, do we do countywide organizations, right? Wow. You're the foundation of the Arlington Way. And now has grown to include 80 member organizations. And whereas, which you can read in your program. Now, therefore, I, Libby Garvey, Chair of the County Board of Arlington, Virginia, do hereby proclaim April 2016 as the month of the 100th anniversary of the Arlington County Civic Federation in Arlington, and urge all residents to celebrate the anniversary of this important community organization and let this event inspire them to assume active roles in the civic responsibility for the betterment of our community and society at large. Thank you so much for all you do. I really look forward to the next 100 years. I won't be here for the whole 100, but I think you're in a really good place, and it's really exciting. So thank you so very much, and I leave this with probably Ms. Pryor.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Joe.
All right. So right now, we're going to take a 200-year journey, 100 years back and 100 years ahead. So first of all, here is where we were in 1916. We had about somewhere between 14,000 and 16,000 people and 7,500 homesteads. If we were to grow at the same amount that we have today, that we would have 15 times more people living in Arlington today. And that would mean we would increase from 8,400 people per capita. And 100 years, that means if we did the same, we would have over 3 million people and 4 million people working in Arlington. According to Victor, that's not going to happen. But it is interesting to see how exponential our increase has been over 100 years and how that the next 100 years clearly has to be at a slower pace. Some projections might be that we would be at 400,000 by 2116. A look back. This is Luna Park. This is basically where Crystal City was today. The roller coaster burned down and it closed essentially in 1916. This is Maori School, which was built in 1910. And today, of course, it's the Arlington Arts Center. Many of you may not really recall that Bailey Crossroad is named after Barnum and Bailey's circus, and that there was a very large circus ground over more than a square mile that basically was in Arlington and Fairfax County. This is Fort Myer in 1917. It's changed a bit. This is Fort Myer was key in lots of ways, and there was, ironically, a streetcar that ran from Roslyn to Fort Myer to Knock, and ran for many years. And here is a shot of Orville Wright at Whipple Field. In Fort Myer in 1908 and 1909. He actually crashed and his co-pilot died, and it was the first airline fatality in the United States. This is the traffic jam on Fort Myer. The pawn shops of Roslyn were very much in operation. They have all gone away. Even the pawn shop restaurant is now gone. This is Glebe House, which is still with us today. And of course, that's part of the reason we have Glebe Road. And actually, Glebe in Alexandria connected Walker's Chapel, and Glebe was the road, that the cow path that connected those two. This is the Ball Cellars, and thus the name Ballston. And overall, we have experienced incredible growth, and that an organization of women and six civic associations banded together and voted to create a sewer system. It is interesting that the vote on both the water system and sewer system passed by almost a margin of 10 to 1. Our county board today would only hope for such endorsement. Based on $27 a year for 1,500 households, they felt they had break even to put the first public sewer system for a county in America. So that's the history of what we've done. The one thing I would just like to note is that we say that we have 80 neighborhood civic associations. That's not true. We actually have over 50 neighborhood organizations, and then we have a lot of very vital organizations like the League of Women Voters, AAUW, and many other functional organizations, the Arlington Education Association, that are a member of it. And when the exhibit goes up with the two posters, there will be a map in the middle where there will be push pins, where you can go and say, yes, I live in Lion Park or Lion Village. I never figured that out, have I, Martha? But you can also take a push pin and put in and say, yes, I'm a member of the League of Women Voters or the Arlington Taxpayers Association or what have you. So please, when you come to the library, put your push pins in and let the people of Arlington know who people are and where you live and where you participate in the Arlington Way. So now, the future, 200 years from now. So, first of all, population growth is a very significant factor in our future. It will determine our future in many ways, in terms of environment, in terms of climate change, in terms of economic development. And there are very significant changes that are going to happen. For instance, Nigeria will overtake the United States as the third largest country in the world. And basically, what is going to happen is that water is going to be the key factor in of all of the factors, whether it's natural resources or other things, food or what have you, access to water, potable water. And people who say climate change is coming are wrong, because it is here. 25 million people have already move from the Sahel area of Africa due to a shortage of water and food due to the lack of water. There are lots of things that are going to happen. There's exciting things that will happen in space, like solar power systems and maybe even a shielding system to protect us. That's the area actually I work in. There are realistic ideas that there will be a lunar colony. Maybe there might even be a colony in Mars. The so-called singularity will probably have happened. Anybody here know the term singularity? So basically, there is a famous artificial intelligence man named Ray Kurzweil, who basically says that in about 20 years, we will have thinking machine robots that will have the intelligence equivalent to a human being that will be available, and that this will make a huge impact on service jobs, because in America, 85% of the jobs today are service jobs. And so what do we mean by work? And by 2116, I think we will have found that we will have to have rethought what we mean by work and services, employment, and a whole host of things. So it will be a very difficult time, I think, of economic adjustment. The U.S. will probably have shrunk to about 4% of the world's population, about 450 million people out of 11.2 billion. These are the United Nations projections for right around the start of the 21st century. Service jobs will continue to dominate the economy. Farming and manufacturing will be essentially automated, but also a lot of service jobs as well. Megadensity is a real key issue, that the world today is 53% urban and is headed to perhaps 85% urban density in the start of the 22nd century. And the U.S. will likely be 85% urban, and urban sprawl. Actually, I have a book called The Future of Future Cities that comes down to urban sprawl is bad, urban density is good, but mega density in urban areas is bad again in terms of a whole host of issues, starting with things like terrorism and security, but also the urban environment and the feeling of participation in community that comes with mega density. We today have about 25 cities that are more than 10 million people. It's projected that we may have as many as 100 by the start of the next century. What will Arlington in 2116, that's a typo, there will perhaps have 400,000 residents, perhaps 350,000 workers. There'll be enormous pressure based on transportation corridors. Without metro, streetcars, monorails, or super buses to relieve that pressure, we will have enormous problems, I think, to deal with. There will be great pressure to bring metro to Shirlington and out 395. There will be real focus on the issues of Lee Highway or Columbia Pike, like a monorail system or simply electronic super buses, which I know the county board is starting to think about. But much of our future will hinge on transportation. High density in Arlington. We are currently at 8,400 per square mile, but what would Arlington look like with as many as 20,000 people per square mile? There are places in the United States today, like in New York and New York City suburbs, that are at that level of density. Certainly, density is starting to happen today, and high-rise schools and such all are starting to happen. We're going to hear from Jack Belcher on broadband systems. We are certainly implementing Connect Arlington today. What will that future be? What will telework Arlington, and perhaps with telework, it could support 1 million workers, but they wouldn't live here. They might live anywhere in the world. So anyway, megadensity, I think, can be a problem. The Indian minister who worries about security in India says overcrowding is choking our cities and dwarfing the capabilities of first responders. Think about the idea of terrorism or fires in a 100-story building. So these are real problems. We must seek creative solutions. One possible idea is the idea of virtual reality. Expand Arlington services without expanding our physical space, schools, hospitals, therapy sessions, library programs, even entertainment venues may be able to create new capabilities. And I really do think virtual reality can be a powerful tool in education, health, research, entertainment. That's just a hopefully a little bit provocative introduction to our speakers tonight, and we are going to start with Adrian. Adrian Stanton is the vice president of Virginia Hospital Center, and he's going to talk a little bit about the future of healthcare. So this is forward.
Well, they get that set up. Thank you very much for inviting me to speak tonight. Joe contacted me and said, hey, can you talk about the future of healthcare? And I said, sure. And he said, for the next 100 years? And I went, not quite sure. And then he said, do it in 8 minutes. This could be real quick because I'm not even sure I could do the next 10 years of healthcare, let alone the next 100. But I'm going to try to give you some thoughts. As Joe said earlier, we've been here in Arlington, the healthcare provider, for the last 72 years. A group of women got together, bought a dairy farm. It's actually the place where the hospital sits today. We've been here, we hope to be here another 100 years, but let me talk about healthcare in general. And I've got maybe good news and bad news. And I try to cull it down to a couple of key points, and I'll go through them rather quickly because I've got 8 minutes, but sort of the top things, increasing healthcare demand. There'll be decreasing healthcare resources, and we think there'll be a big change in accessibility of healthcare, primarily due to a function of the advances of technology. We'll continue to see reimbursement shifts, and in that vein, a greater transparency about the value of healthcare, different than the way we've looked at it today. And I'll end with the last one is, and that's a question mark, will that be a narrowing of the healthcare resources that we have? Let me talk first about the healthcare demand, and Joe talked about the population increases. The significant part for us on the healthcare side is, once you get past 65, things sort of change with regard to your need for healthcare services. So right now, I think roughly the 65 plus population represents around 15% of the population. It represents over 50% of the use of healthcare services. And the projection is that that 65 population is going to grow dramatically over the next 10 to 20 years. And again, that will have this increasing demand on healthcare services as we see that huge baby boomer group move into the 65 plus population, and that's a real command for it. Here's the one that worries us. As that huge demand to healthcare grows, this is what we're seeing with regard to the resources, and the big resources for us are people, physicians, nurses, ancillary support. Hard to see, but on the left-hand side is the red line is the demand for physicians going out to 2025. The blue line is the number of physicians that will be available. There's just not that many people who are choosing to be physicians, and we see a real gap in the demand and supply. On the right-hand side is the similar chart for nurses. The demand is the purple line going up. The supply has sort of flattened out. And the part that all of us are seeing is a high percentage of our nurses are in the 45 plus age group. And the question is, are the younger millennials going to seek healthcare? And frankly, they have a lot of options. So what we're seeing is a potential of not having the supply to meet the demand. Accessible healthcare. We're already seeing this today. The question is, where will this go? And right now, we have access to get information and healthcare information that doesn't require someone to come into the hospital, that you could actually wear it, that you could actually transport information via your phone to us at the hospital, and we can read how things are going and determine whether or not you need to come in or not. And I think you'll just see that advance as technology continues to advance. It really will get to, when you want healthcare, for example, your primary care physician, I mean, right now today it is, when can I make an appointment? It used to be you'd have to wait till you call during office hours. Now you can go online at any time of the day, whenever you want, make the appointment and everything's set up. In the future, that may be you're sending your information about how your heart's working, how your vital signs are working, and all that's read remotely, and we can tell you if it's an issue or not, you need to come in, and we'll see if technology advances such that you don't even have to come in. I think the other big one that is already happening that will become even more pronounced over the next 10 years is what I'll call transparency in healthcare. And what this is, and sorry to sort of bore you with the numbers of this, but the government pays healthcare providers, hospitals, based on what they call their value. They call it value-based purchasing. And all that means is they have a set of criteria that looks at how well hospitals are doing on three things. How well they're doing on the quality of care they provide, so outcomes, are they safe? Are we creating more problems than we're fixing? They look at service. How good is the experience that we provide to patients as seen by patients? And then they look at cost. I roll those three together, that's the value of healthcare. The government does that and they roll it together with those metrics and they come up with a number, And that number basically tells how they're going to reimburse us. So what the government said is, we're not paying you just because you do a procedure. We're going to pay you based on how well you do it. We, as community members, aren't really aware of this just yet, but it's coming. And I think what that will change for us is, as we start to select healthcare, we will have more access to information to say, are they truly a quality or a value provider, and are you getting what you pay for healthcare? And that will become very apparent for us and very easy for us to access as you make those decisions. I leave you with the last one, which is a piggyback on the first one, which is, as that information on quality providers comes to the forefront, then as people make decisions, that may narrow the networks. And in other words, it's happening today with large corporations who are paying a huge amount for healthcare benefits for their employees, and they're looking at healthcare providers and saying, who's providing the quality service? And we will select who are the providers for our employees. The employees may still feel that they have a choice. What they don't know is the company has said, it's not five providers we're going to have. We've narrowed it to two, and your choice is between one or the other. How extensive that will be as we move forward, I don't know. And it will be interesting how that plays off of our feelings about the ability to choose healthcare. So I hope I've hit my 8-minute mark, but that's my thought on the future of healthcare.
Next, we have from Victor Ferkus. Hoskins. I'm sorry, I have an old professor named Victor Ferkus. That's all right. So, Victor is going to tell us about the business and economic profile of Arlington, and see what he can do in terms of 100 years in 8 minutes.
Thank you, Joe. Thank you. Oh. I want to begin by saying I was very fortunate when I was young. I was an avid reader of science fiction. I absolutely love science fiction. I don't know how many of you here were, you know, like Isaac Asimov. Like, a lot of people don't know that he's the one that wrote iRobot. And a lot of people thought that was like, you know, Will Smith. So, not. So, and I also read Ray Bradbury. I loved Ray Bradbury, you know, The Martian Chronicles, Fahrenheit 451. I just loved that. I just loved that book, you know. I think part of it was it could take you to another place. It could take you to the future. And the thing that I noticed that, like with B.F. Skinner and Walden 2, different visions of the future, utopia, you know, some of it kind of post-apocalyptic. But the reality is that I think that what happened to me was when I saw Flash Gordon, when I saw the original Star Trek, yes, there was an original Star Trek before The Next Generation and all that other stuff. I think that it formed a vision of the future for me, which one was one of a very optimistic future. If you come into office right now, you will see actually the Star Trek crew with my favorites up there, including Leonard Nimoy. But what I want to do tonight is really talk about kind of another vision of the future. And this is 100 years, so you know you can check me if I'm wrong, okay? I call you to do that. Now, with these medical advances, you might be around. You never know. So I want to start with a video and a vision
since
that someone has of the future.
Since the dawn of humanity, we have strived to enhance our living and working environments. Over the years, we have witnessed numerous quantum leap moments which have totally transformed our lives, from the invention of the car to the arrival of the internet. Today, we are making the next giant stride, the age of the smarter home, enabling us to monitor, control, and secure our living spaces with the touch of a smartphone. At any time and from anywhere, we can now switch on lights, turn up thermostats, unlock the back door, all from the palm of your hand using Samsung SmartThings technology. A century ago, advances in technology like these would have seemed impossible. So what can we expect to see in the next 100 years? As city space becomes more squeezed, we will burrow deeper and build higher. Towering megastructures will dwarf today's skyscrapers, while earthscrapers will tunnel 25 stories deep or more. Underwater cities are likely to become a reality, using the water itself to create breathable atmospheres and generating hydrogen fuel in the process. Doc Brown in Back to the Future said, Where we're going, we don't need roads. He may have got the year wrong, but his forecast about transport is likely to be correct. Some of us will be travelling the skyways with our own personal flying drones, some strong enough to carry entire homes around the world for holidays. Flexible, smart walls will mean you won't ever need to decorate. LED room surfaces will adapt to suit your mood. When it comes to entertaining, there'll be no more botched recipes or pizza deliveries. We will download dishes from famous chefs and 3D print everything from gourmet meals to our favourite cakes in minutes. Our working lives will be transformed with holograms allowing us to attend meetings virtually without leaving home. This may lead to a shorter working week, but the strategic sickie will be the thing of the past. Step-in home Medipods will confirm if you are really ill, providing a digital diagnosis and supplying medicine or a remote surgeon if needed. And finally, the next giant leap will see Earth as solar century as we start colonizing space. First the moon, then Mars, and then beyond, out into the galaxy. Remember, these are just predictions for the century ahead. But with technical and medical breakthroughs moving apace and an ever-increasing life expectancy, you may not need to take my word for it. You might just be around to see it for yourselves.
What I wanted to do is just give you kind of a futurist view and then talk a little bit about Arlington. What's happening in Arlington right now, it's going through a transformation in terms of its economy. Our government services are shrinking. Our med tech is growing and evolving into biotech and personalized medicine. Our ed tech is going to take leaps and bounds. And we're really evolving into a more cybersecurity, robotics, biomed, big data environment. And I think that by 2116, we will certainly be there. What's going to change? And I'll just, because I only have about 5 minutes left, that was 2.5 minutes, and I burned about 30 other seconds. What I want to do is talk about like how some of this is going to happen. You know, in construction, like construction methods are going to change totally. They will not involve people. They will actually involve swarms of drone machines. Now, you're probably sitting there going like, really? But think about it. If you could program a drone to layer bricks, for example, one drone to come in to layer cement, another drone to come in to drop a brick, and another drone to come in and drop another brick, that's one methodology. They're also talking about 3D printing houses. They've already done it. That's printing houses at scale. They're creating cars by 3D printing. I mean, it is really revolutionizing how a lot of work is going to be done. And the challenge is going to be, what do we do? You know, how do we really develop our purpose in life? And I think that one of the great things that Arlington is poised for is really dealing with a purpose in life. Arlington, I think, is going to be one of the few cities in a country that actually gets to zero homeless. That's because of the heart of the people of Arlington. The numbers have gone from over 800 to down 172 now, and they are really fighting to get it to zero. That's purpose. And I think that kind of purpose is going to become more important. You know, there's a book called The Age of Unreason, written by a gentleman named Charles Handy. He's passed away now. He was a professor emeritus at CMC out in California, but also from the London School of Economics. In short, what he said was that we will live three lives: one life learning how to work, the second life actually working, and a third life giving back. I mean, essentially, that is the kind of the purpose of our lives going into the future. How are we going to get around? Hey, isn't that nice? Okay, so this is something that is actually a prototype that they are saying will be flying in the next decade. Okay, this thing travels at over 1,000 miles an hour. They actually are looking at some that travel 3,500 miles an hour. At that speed, you can get across the country in about 45 minutes. The interesting thing is about, let me back up to this. The interesting thing about this, you won't need airports. By 2116, our airport won't really need it. You could actually stack planes because they'll be able to stop and hover. And that's something that we don't even think about these days. So much is going to change that we won't even recognize it. Can you imagine getting in a Hyperloop and going to New York in 30 minutes? I'd love to do that. If you've been on Amtrak, you know that'd be a gift. Self-driving cars, this is not hyperbole. This is going to happen. This is a destiny. Someone told me that 80 robotics engineers were recruited out of Carnegie Mellon to work for Uber. I'm telling secrets out of turn. The only reason I found this out is because this was an investment guy, and it's public now, I said it. They are working for Uber to create a self-driving car. There will not be Uber drivers. There will be Uber cars, but they will not be drivers, and they will get you to your destination with zero energy, and because a lot of these cars will be running off batteries or self-generating energy. Virtual reality, Oculus Rift. Oculus Rift is going to transform how we communicate. Like right now, when I talk to my mother, I get on the telephone. If my mother was a little less afraid, she'd actually do FaceTime with me. Okay, but I do FaceTime with my grandson, my daughter, my son-in-law in Chicago all the time. Can you imagine putting on a pair of glasses, not those big clumsy ones that they have right now, but you know, 50 years from now, you'll just be able to put on a pair of glasses and you'll be able to see the reality that the person that you're talking to is sitting in. Doctors will be able to walk into a body, into a brain, and be able to find tumors and look at tumors and locate tumors and diagnose treatments. It's going to be a very, very different world in very short order. Artificial intelligence. Now, this scares some people. Anybody here ever, did you read iRobot? Okay, that's scary because that's a fun book, but did you see iRobot? That was even scarier, okay? But a lot of people fear this, but I don't think it's gonna be quite the way that they've been portraying it in movies, and this is certainly not gonna be the way in Arlington. I think a lot of people in Arlington wanna do their own work, but there will be a lot of things that we won't want to do, like cut the lawn, or I mean, like me, I don't like cleaning gutters. I like a robot for that. But also, they'll be able to, you know, retrieve drinks, bring your medication, tell you when you need to go to sleep, tell you when you need to wake up, tell you when you're late for work. You know, all the things that, you know, are irritating. Zero energy buildings. This will be the standard. All buildings that will be built will not be consuming energy. They will actually be producing energy. The Arlington experience. So we're moving forward right now. The economy is going to change quite a bit. We don't know exactly how it's going to be, but I know my grandson will be around to see it. Thank you very much.
So next we have here from Jack Belcher. I had the honor to work with him as chairman of the IT Commission for a number of years, and he's going to give us a further feeling, maybe closer at hand, what we can expect in broadband in Arlington. Thank you.
Thank you all for inviting me tonight. Well, where are we? We're at the verge of a digital revolution, and it's taking place. We're in the third decade of that digital revolution, and it's having impact in many, many ways today, and it's going to have many, many impact on us in the future. A gentleman at Intel Corporation, Gordon Moore, projected that there's an increase of twofold every year in terms of the power and performance of technology. And he went back 30 years and found that that's been continuing. And you say, well, what does that mean? There's an Indian fable that talks about this gentleman who developed the chessboard, and he presented it to the Emperor of India, and I find out from my deputy who's an Indian, he said, that must have been many, many years ago, and I said, it was, and he said to him, what do you think of this? And the Emperor of India said, this is fantastic, I want this, you can have anything in my kingdom today, no questions asked. And he said, I just want one thing. And he said, what's that? I want a single piece of grain put on one of the squares on the chessboard, and I want you to double that for every square on the chessboard. For those of you who don't know, and I didn't know this until earlier, there's 64 squares on the chessboard. So what's the total number that comes out of that? 18.4 quadrillion grains of rice. And so when you thought about this a second, the emperor said, well, I'm gonna end this. And so he had him beheaded and kept the chessboard. So maybe when I finish this, my boss, the county manager, will say, I'm gonna behead him. But we're at a digital revolution, and it's happening right now in front of us. Imagine, if you can, 30 Gutenberg moments. The Gutenberg press I'm talking about. Imagine how that changed the world. We could have as many as 30 taking place right now. The whole mindset is changing now in terms of how we do things. It's being turned over topsy-turvy. We used to think that to build an industry, you needed to have people, places, things. It took time to do it. Think about what's the largest taxi cab company in the world today. It's Uber. They do not own a taxi cab. Uber does not own a taxi cab. What's the largest hotel chain in America, in the world today? Airbnb. They do not own a hotel. And that's what's happening around us. Some projections, and I'm gonna look a little closer than Victor did. I'm gonna come right in the next few years here. What's happening? What do we see happening? The price of solar energy is decreasing at such a rate that what cost $30 in 1984 to produce a kilowatt hour of solar energy now costs less than 15 cents. 15 cents. The oil industry, as you know it now, it's gonna go away. So if Tom Whipple was here, I don't see him in the audience, he'd be saying, but what? Is that gonna happen? Yeah, it's gonna happen. Medicine. Who of you remember Star Trek? Watch Star Trek. Do you remember Leonard Nimoy? And he had this thing called a tricorder. Do you remember that? And he took it and he went over your body and he could find out what's going on and he could say, well, you got this injury or that. I don't know how many of you know this, but Qualcomm has a $10 million competition going on where they want to find somebody who can invent a device just like that, that's less than 5 pounds, that be consumerized, that could go to a body, be used by someone at home, and they could run it up and down the body and find out whether or not they had certain diseases, what your heart rate was, much of the things we just heard me talk about. They're in the final stages. To win that award, you have to be able to do a diagnosis better than 10 board-qualified physicians. They have 7 teams done, ready to go. They're going to make the award in March of this year coming up. Imagine that. I defy you to go to your doctor and ask him about this. He will say, I have no idea about it. Why? Because his whole field is being disrupted, the way he does business. Every job that exists today, every occupation, has been, is being, and will be disrupted in the next 10 years. It's going to happen. We can't ignore it. Staying with medicine just a minute, there's something called microbiomes. I would not know what that means. What they are is the bacteria in the stomach. We've been able to map the DNA of the human body. And what they've been able to find out, that mixing and matching the this microbiome, the good and the bad bacteria, they can cure and prevent type 2 diabetes. Think about that. Not doing any surgery, just doing something like that. So that's medicine. Transportation. Talk a little bit about transportation. Right now, there are 19,000 taxi cabs in Manhattan, and there are 190,000 cars that course through Manhattan in a day. The estimates are that you could take 9,000 autonomous vehicles, those are the driverless vehicles, the Google vehicles, they could serve the entire New York City, and you would have a wait of no longer than 36 seconds to get a ride. So think about what that means in terms of what we're doing, what we're investing, what our priorities are. We just talked about Metro and what Metro means, how do we keep it running? But if you had the opportunity to provide some type of transit like that at an affordable price, is that something we should be really thinking about? Government. Government is one of the few organizations that has not changed. Our policies, procedures, regulations, they were developed 30, 40, 50, 100 years ago. They serve government. And we do a very good job here in Arlington County. We provide great services. The problem is that our residents don't want to do that. They're used to a different type of service. And I'm sure you are. When it's holiday time, you go on to Amazon, you find the good you want, you find the best price, you see what others have said about it, you order it, you have it delivered when you want, and if you don't like it, you put it in a box and ship it back. They want government to act that way. But government is based on status, keeping the status quo, making sure that everything's going along fine. And now what we're seeing is this digital revolution taking place. What do we do? How do we handle that? So where we're at now is at a crossroads. Where are we going? What's going to be our digital destiny? Where are we going as a community? We're doing Connect Arlington, you just talked about it, fiber optic network. We're putting in the most robust, powerful fiber optic network ever put in anywhere. I will challenge the quality of that against anything, anywhere, Google, anyone else. Very shortly, we'll be coming to the county board, and we have a major university that's going to ask us if they could set up a TerraPop in Arlington County. A TerraPop would be 43 links of 100 to 300 gigabits per link coursing out of Arlington County off of the network. Now you say, what's that mean to me? That's 3,000 times what you have at home today accessing Comcast or Verizon. Just think of the possibilities that are going to come out of that. So we're starting to lay that foundation. The question is, how do we define Arlington's digital destiny? And what we want to do, what I would like to do, has asked your help. The one thing you people have done, you and the people before you, you don't do the easy. You can figure out anything. If given a challenge, given the roadmap to where to go, you can figure how to get there. So this revolution is happening. We know it's coming. So how can we, as a community, go after that and address that? Because if we don't, things are going to happen that may be good and they may be bad. Security issues, privacy. We were just talking a few minutes ago about education. What could happen there? So with that, that is my speech. Thank you.
So we've heard a lot about technology and how our world is changing. Now we're going to hear the wise words of our county manager about how this all comes together and how at least community involvement and community planning has to be a part of that future, regardless of the technology.
Wow. First of all, I want to welcome Congressman Beyer, Colonel Henderson, everyone, and current board members, former board members, and everybody in the audience. I'm thrilled to be here. And several of you pointed out when you're making predictions about what's going to happen 100 years from now, there's no way that you can be proven wrong. So I'm going to start off with saying something which I know is absolutely going to happen, that I can confidently state 100 years from now, Arlington County will be a community that treasures its open space, supports those who are less fortunate, and provides an appealing mixture of elements that make up our urban village, and it will remain a wonderful place to live, work, play, and visit. So, how can I be so confident? There are forces much bigger than what are going on in Arlington that shape the contours of our future. The environment, I'm surprised no one said that we'll be underwater and overheated. Our nation, I was going to say debt or solvent, but we're debt now, and I think it's likely we'll still be in debt then. The Commonwealth of Virginia, growing, adopting more progressive values, possibly. Our technology, you've heard a lot about that. So the choices that confront the county board, and we just went through a sort of marathon conversation about what would make up our 2017 budget, I think those will be in some ways the same choices we face in 100 years. How much for education? How much for housing? How much will we need to keep ourselves safe? We may not be debating about school buildings. We may be talking about virtual environments for our kids to learn in. We're certainly still going to need houses for our residents. I have no idea what kind of houses, and there's probably going to be some architectural breakthrough or some concept. We recently heard about micro units. Maybe there'll be mini micro, tiny, teeny units. We have transportation solutions that we've heard about. So again, with all that, why am I confident? And really, for me, it doesn't come down to technology. It doesn't really come down to the wonderful vistas we have of our nation's capital. It comes down to the people. We've heard a lot of talk about technology, but I want to talk about the people. A very special kind of people. Not just people who need people. But, I'm not doing the whole song for you. But instead, people who work with each other and work hard to help others. So throughout the United States and the world, we have a prevalence of technology. We have an ease of travel that's occurred recently. We have the global scale of economies. We have the spread of personal dignity and the spread of freedom. And they've all created a very different world. Now, this may surprise some of you, but I'm going to quote David Brooks, who is a columnist for the New York Times. And he wrote an article on April 5th entitled, How Covenants Make Us. And I want to read some of his words to you. All these forces, and those are the forces I just mentioned about technology and the scale of global economies and personal dignity, all of these forces have liberated the individual, or at least well-educated individuals, but they have been bad for national cohesion and social fabric. Income inequality challenges economic cohesion as the classes divide. Demographic diversity challenges cultural cohesion as different ethnic groups rub against one another. The emphasis on individual choice challenges community cohesion and settled social bonds. Now the weakening, and then he continues, the weakening of the social fabric has created a range of problems. Alienated young men join ISIS so they can have a sense of belonging. Isolated teenagers shoot up schools. Many people grow up in fragmented, disorganized neighborhoods. Political polarization grows because people often don't interact with those on the other side. Racial animosity stubbornly persists. So after reading this and hearing that, I had to pause, because each of the trends that David Brooks had talked about, to a degree, have unglued the bonds of society in the world. But as I thought about it, each of those trends has done the exact opposite here in Arlington. Think about it. We are a place that epitomizes diversity. We're a place where individual choice and dignity have grown and not led to a greater sense of alienation, but a greater sense of inclusiveness. We have great neighborhoods where people who are very different from each other interact all the time. That doesn't mean we don't have troubles. The income inequality we see in our country is still here in our community. But we're a community through its people that are committed, through our spirit, and what I've seen here in the last 31 years that I've lived, is that as technology grows and as all the new trends come about, it has aided our diversity. It's increased the diversity of our neighborhoods. It's increased our civic spirit and made it more resilient. So I have no reason to think that 100 years from now we won't be that much more resilient than we are today. We take strength from our differences. Those differences that David Brooks talked about are strengths for us. We admit that we have challenges. We don't talk about building walls, we talk about the walls of buildings. I like that line. I just spent a lot of time on that. If you want me to say it again, I will. We don't talk about ignoring those less fortunate, which is what we're hearing a lot on the national scene. We talk about how to help those less fortunate. We may have a difference of opinion. Should it be AHIF or housing grants? Should it be housing grants or AHIF? These are debates that I welcome all the time. We certainly can do better, but we're in a good place. We learn from each other. We have a civic life rich in engagement, and we have a generous spirit as a community. Now, David Brooks went on to note in his column that these days the social fabric will be repaired. This is how his recipe will be repaired by hundreds of millions of people making local covenants, widening their circles of attachment across income, social, and racial divides. But it will probably also require leaders drawing upon American history to revive patriotism. They'll tell a story that includes the old themes, that we're a universal nation, the guarantor of stability and world order, but it will transcend the old narrative and offer an updated love of America. I think one place they could look is Arlington County. So our secret sauce is really no secret at all. It's our constant devotion to our community, and it's our people, the civic culture we have. So in conclusion, let me note another great person of our times, Groucho Marx. He once said, "Why should I care about future generations? What have they done for me?" Groucho had a point. What has the future done for us? Well, here in Arlington, for the last 100 years, and I suspect for the next 100 years, the future does one incredible thing. It holds out promise for us. A promise that what we have today is valuable, and we want others to share in it. A future filled with hope that will nurture our days while we're all alive as members of this community each and every day. And that is the reason why I'm confident about our future. And thank you for inviting me to speak tonight. Thank you.
You've been very patient, listened very well. Now it's your turn. We need some help to redeploy the tables so that all of our distinguished speakers can field questions from this cohesive, covenant-driven audience. Okay, so we've heard a lot about technology. We've heard a whole lot about the future tonight. At the gala, we focus more on 100 years in the past. We don't really have to focus 100 years in the future, but the object was to stretch our minds a little bit and think outside the box that we usually think within. So who will be the first to, yes, please.
Thank you.
Say your name and.
Sandra Borden, Crystal City Civic Association. And I welcome all of you, and it's been thought-provoking. I'd like to hear more specifics on economic development, because we in Arlington have a unique tax environment where we depend on our businesses. And so I'm just wondering about an update on economic development.
So Victor, I think that's you.
So did you want that like short term or 100 years from now? Were you thinking more in the near term? Or
near term.
Okay. So one of the things that we're focusing on, obviously, is the vacancy rate, because the vacancy rate has affected the balance. But fortunately, we had some good things that happened on the tax side this year. We have a nice, we're still in that 50-50 range, which is where we want to be. We've also had some success in landing some companies and also expanding some existing companies. So it looks bright right now. It's going to take us 4 or 5 years to actually tackle that. It's about a 10% that we're trying to, you know, push down. It's going to take a little while to do that, but we'll get there, and we are on track now.
Victor, if I could add, there have been rumors that Vornado may be selling off their interest and so on, that there was a lot of enthusiasm for this redevelopment of Crystal City as the city of the future with energy efficiency and so on. Where do you think we are in Crystal City and those initiatives?
I don't think Vornado's selling anything.
Great.
And they actually have some great plans, and right. They've been talking to us about those plans, so I think you'll be very confident about the future of Crystal City and Vornado.
Great.
And if I can pile on a little bit, you know, we're looking at this enormous economic transformation in the country, but also especially in Arlington. And we see it first in the impact of sequestration. And, you know, the federal government's driven the economy for so long, and it will not as much as it in the future as it has in the past, which is not necessarily a bad thing, but it means that we're going to be creating different kinds of jobs. Another impact is what we see with office space, where there used to be, you know, one person per 800 feet or 1,000 square feet or 500 square feet. Now it's one per 100 square feet. So we have all this empty office space, not because the jobs aren't there, but people are working from home. Very different realities. So the biggest thing probably is folks like 1776. We're getting the Arlington is a wonderful place for millennials, and millennials are not interested in working for anybody else, as you probably know. So you're seeing all these startups and all this economic entrepreneurial energy, which is going to create an Arlington that looks very different from an employment standpoint than it has in the past.
Okay, next question. Yes, please.
Randy Swart from Barcroft. We heard just one mention of the environment and what might happen to us someday. But if you notice, Alexandria, Blue Plains, D.C. have all put up some kind of barriers or are working on some kind of barriers for floodwaters. I'd like to know, obviously, if they keep the water out, it's going to come here. Mm-hmm. So I'd like to know.
Good point.
Our sewage treatment plant would be the first thing to wash out, I assume, so I'd like to know what Arlington's plans are.
Well, let me speak to that just very quickly, which is that our environmental services staff have done an analysis. It's better than back of the envelope. They went out and did some consulting work. The one area in Arlington that's most likely to be affected, and I'm sorry Margaret McKeough isn't here to hear this, is National Airport. Mm-hmm. That is actually going to be the one place that will be most affected. The the water pollution control plant likely would not, and it's those areas right along Roach's Run and in National Airport. So I'm sure Congress will come up with a solution for that, so I'm not worried at all.
That's right after Memorial Bridge.
Right. One miracle at a time, right?
And then larger picture, I mean, there are obviously enormous things going on around the world on climate change. And I am actually fairly optimistic that Congress is moving in the right direction, only because we don't have any choice. It's becoming so obvious to everyone. But the dilemma is that we're acting so late that that we're going to need accommodation for an awful lot of the stuff that's going to happen no matter what we do on a climate change. You know, what we're trying to do is hold off 6 feet and limiting it to 2 feet. You know, holding off 6 degrees and limiting it to 2.5 or 3 degrees. You probably saw the projection now for 2500, which is a long time away, is a 42-foot sea level rise. And that changes the shape of the continent.
Next question.
I thought I was leaving. I'm Edie Wilson from Shirlington, and then I go down in the elevator, and there's a book that they're giving away. And I was going to leave, and then I picked it up. It's Congress and Urban Problems, 1969, Brookings Institution, Congress and Clean Air, the Issue of Enforcement, 1963. It's wonderful. You'll have great fun with it.
We got the Clean Air Act and the Clean Water Act in 1972.
So. Exactly.
I think the problem was that Congressman Beyer had donated that book at the book sale.
Yes, please.
Hi, thanks. I'm Scott Pedowitz from Courthouse Clarendon. I want to have a little fun with my question here. You all looked outward a century and tried to project trends. What I'd like for each of you to think of something that would be an event that could be foreseen, but that we couldn't know what would happen after it, kind of that all bets are off moment, that there's some disruptor, whether it's sudden or goes over time, and then all the plans are back to the drawing board. Looking out a century, what do you think could happen that we don't know how to react to?
Well, we could have Donald Trump as president, that would be. And after that,
Jack?
Yes, you, Jack.
You're Mr. Disruptor.
Yeah, Mr. Disruptor. I think there are two trends. I mentioned one, and that's the idea that the world's driven by oil. That's going to change. It's going to change quickly. So the question is, if they don't have oil, then how do they make an income, and what do they do? The other area is the Chinese. The Chinese economy is based on making cheap parts for America. We've reduced the cost of 3D printers from $10,000 a printer to less than 100. You can go into Staples today and buy them. In fact, there's a maker square around here. And today, yesterday, I believe, we had the first 3D printer make a part in space off the United States. So all of a sudden that happens. What do the Chinese do? And I think one of the first things they do, they start calling back their loans because they've got a real problem on their hands. And so you've got two countries, two worlds, which you've really got to address. And how do you make sure, I mean, it's all about balance. It's not putting up walls, as Mark said. You know, these countries need to survive as well. I see that as the big disruptor.
Now, I think it's interesting to look at what the UN projections are for the populations of India and China. Interestingly enough, they're projecting that China's population will shrink from 1.4 billion down to a billion in 100 years, and that India will continue to grow to close to 2 billion. It is a tremendous impact either way, but in other words, China is going to become more and more wealthy, and India is going to become a huge problem area for housing, resources, consumption, food, and what have you. So just looking at demographic projections tells us interesting things about the future. Anyone else want to talk about disruptor?
I was interested with your question, trying to figure out what I would put out there. And the one that comes to me is, and we're already down that path, we've partnered with the Mayo Clinic, but the work on genomics is phenomenal. And in my simple mind, the way I'd characterize it is today we treat basically everybody the same. You come in, you have cancer, we have a protocol, we treat your cancer. The future, where we will be looking at individuals as individuals based on their genes, and not only treating, but probably preventing that disease. Mm-hmm. And I guess that means there's no need for hospitals. That's a disruptor for us.
Think about how I feel about the self-driving cars.
Sorry.
Yes, please.
Paul Gady from Arlington. I've got a suggestion for another disruptor for you, and it's called an electromagnetic pulse that can be easily set off by any rogue nation with an atomic weapon like North Korea and probably Iran as well before too long. It could take out a bunch of stuff in the United States, all of our electronic gear and the grid. We'd be dead for about 2 years. How about addressing that?
Well, if I could be so bold to comment, because actually that's one of the areas I'm working on, that the big disruptor that no one knows about is the fact that our magnetic poles are shifting, that the North Pole is already down to Siberia and so on, and that there are projections that the protective shield of the Van Allen belts, which protects us from major solar events called coronal mass ejections, could go down to 15% of what they are today. And so the big threat, in my view, is not a terrorist EMP, but actually a electromagnetic event stemmed by a solar coronal mass ejection. And we've had the Carrington event of 1859, that if it happened today, which turned telegraph offices on fire. We had in 1989 the Montreal event that wiped out electric power from Chicago to Montreal, the Halloween event in Scandinavia in 2002. So this is a real threat. There are actually bills in Congress to talk about assessing the problems of solar as well as man-made terrorist events. And really, this could be a huge disruptor that billions of people could be affected if we don't do something looking forward.
Oh. John Burroughs, I live near the Air Force Memorial, and I'm a baby boomer. Been living here almost 31 years. There are two highly populated countries in the world, the People's Republic of China, which is not really a republic. It's a military dictatorship. And the economy there is really, really shaky. That's a serious problem. There's also another highly populated country, the Republic of India, which is the representative form of government. That is the future. That's the past, that's the present, that's the future. The strength of representative form of government that has a constitution with a bill of rights that means something. When I have a problem, I call Comcast or whatever, and usually the person I'm talking to is another republic called the Republic of the Philippines, or maybe someone located at the Republic of India, never the People's Republic of China. Now, a couple years ago, I'm almost finished here, the Ford company decided to build Ford-built cars, not in China, but in the Republic of India. Ford bangers, four cylinders, wonderful cars. That's not sold in this country, but sold in India. They're making a mint. I think the future is with the Republic of India. We should trade more with the Republic of India. China, it's the wrong investment. Thank you.
I'm still really nervous about the electromagnetic pulse. That's really
there are some solutions.
Well, actually, I would like to make one comment about that, and I think that, I don't know if anybody else wants to add, which is that when we had in this area, the derecho, which I think was at this point 3 years ago, where we had straight line winds come in that essentially knocked out our 911 call center, that was, I don't want to say a wake-up call, no pun intended, but we as we become more reliant on technology, there also need to be some, as part of resilience, some attention again to some of those old-fashioned kinds of ways of doing things. And so at the derecho, we had people walk from their houses over to firehouses, and there we had a separate radio set up. We need to be able to have those alternatives planned and put out. It won't eliminate the disruption, but at least we'll give some sense of security. And we've just started focusing on that. It's something we need to spend more time on, because you're right. I mean, these electromagnetic pulses could come at any time.
And one quick comment on China versus India. Right now, the official numbers are 1.5 billion people in China, 1.3 billion in India, although the Indian number is typically understated. The difference is that China is struggling with the 4-2-1 problem, four grandparents, two parents, and one child, and you can see a significant change in its population. India, on the other hand, experimented with birth control back in the 70s, had a very bad experience with it. And right now, the Hindus versus the Muslims versus the Christians are all competing to see who can have the most children. So they really have a population situation that's out of control. And the implications of that, I think, are not good.
Yes, go ahead.
I'm interested in, you probably aren't the best panel for this, but I'm interested, perhaps in the audience, looking at 100 years from now, what civic life is going to look like. I think I could be wrong, but I think the nature of civic engagement has changed over the last 100 years. I think at the Civic Federation, things are going good, but I think we're also having a lot of problems getting committee chairs to serve on various committees and filling up committees, and this is not entirely new. But I think there's also the dimension of religious civic life, which played a tremendously important role in the history of Arlington, and we now have enormous millennial generation and others who are not religious in their orientation, or at least in a community orientation. And so the civic role of the religious groups, I think, is changing and diminishing. So would like to hear comments from anybody that has any interesting thoughts on that matter.
Stephanie, why don't you come up here and comment on that? Because it really is, it is your problem.
So going back to some of my comments from before, I know Ms. Bating and I, we're looking around, and also with Ms. Koontz, we're saying, okay, how do we get to that next generation? As Ms. Koontz has pointed out, you know, the parents with the children, granted, they're only 20% of our Arlington County population. But once they see with the PTA, the Parents Teachers Association, all the things that need to be done and pay attention to see what's changing, we're also looking at, we've met some amazing people, absolutely amazing people. And my mother fussed at me the other day. She said, well, I'm getting old. I'm 69. I laughed and I said, my secretary is 75 and I'm looking at his vacation pictures at Airbnb in Venice, and he learned how to speak Italian at the library. I said, don't tell me you're old. So trying to get the younger generation to see the amazing depth and breadth of knowledge that we have here in this community, getting to know the neighbors. I know with a new neighbor just moved in, and he actually works for PBS. And as Mr. Schneider said, I believe on Friday night, everyone smiles when you say that you work for the public television. It's very true. He's already a superstar in our street. But knowing my neighbors, that when something happened, I could call them, I could show up at their door, we sit out on the porch and drink wine together, and yes, I'm old enough to do that. But it's one of those things that trying to get people to see the benefits, yeah, there's a lot of work behind this, but we're also trying to say it's an amazing, amazing group of people here. So that's, I know, what we're gonna keep trying to do to try and get some different generation in, as well as we just introduced one of our youngest, hopefully future members, Alex Paget, who is one of our Career Center students, was introduced to Mr. Schneider on Friday night. So here we have a junior in high school meeting the chief operating officer from WIDA. Hopefully he'll tell some of his friends and say, you know, yeah, we know there's a few gray hairs in there, and I know I've got mine for sure, but there's some amazing people. So hopefully we can keep that kind of direction going. And I know definitely the sense of humor too, Mr. Schwartz. I definitely want to thank you for that. So hopefully, but definitely speak out to your neighbors as well. So Ms. Koontz in the back?
Well, I would just add, obviously we're preaching to the choir here, but I am a believer in the community service aspect of life in Arlington or wherever, but neighborhood associations, to the extent that we can get people interested, babysitting co-ops. But I like the theme of resilience that I heard as well, and all of that contributes, but it can also be more deliberate. I've been trained in emergency response by the CERT group in Arlington. It's open to anyone. It starts you thinking about scenarios. What if? Mm-hmm. And I've only had one instance where that training was put into action, and it was a very small instance, but I was the only person on the street who had any idea what to do when this person was struck by a truck. A pedestrian, and I didn't end up actually doing all that much, but it was astonishing how instantly everyone around in the crowd deferred and then jumped in and played a role as well. So I put that in there as a thought that resilience is an individual responsibility that reaches out to community, and I think we all want to think in terms of our role. Very explicitly. Yeah.
One of the things just structurally that I think we should continue to pursue is the idea of universal community service for our young people. You know, just a year at age 18 or 19, it would help solve the problem of college tuitions, college debt, and more than anything, and you know, it's a choice, everything from the CCC to the military or anything in between. There are enormous needs in our communities for caregivers, and what better than to give them the concept of a life of service at the right age?
Ms. Bating, did you have anything to add?
I have a comment. I think you have a very good point. My name is Elvira Banks, and I live in Arlington for about at least, I don't know, 30 years. And you have a very good point about millennials and the religious aspect. I think it's very important. Like, I know this church, received an award because they were involved in, helping people, and I think it's wonderful. And I think all these churches and religion really helps, makes people think of other people, of community service, of being, unselfish. And what I'm concerned as a parent that I've seen is gradually schools, I know the parents are very important, but schools, like public schools, they should speak about religion to the kids. I mean, like sometimes, right now, you can't even talk about Santa Claus around Christmas time because someone can be offended. But, this country had been, started on liberty and freedom, and you can express your opinion. And I think every religion, you can go to school and you can talk about any religion, but the thing is right now, because someone can be offended, you're not teaching values and you're not teaching religion. And that's why maybe a lot of the millennials right now, they haven't even heard of it because someone can be offended or something, when it really helps the community, it helps people, or that church has been awarded. And also it helps a sense of community and talking between religion. And you're seeing all these dialogues between Muslims or Christians or whatever. If you really talk about religion and explain which one, every of them, that would also help dialogue and more peace. So that's my 2 cents of opinion. Thank you.
I would just add 2 comments. One is that we started out very much focused on neighborhoods, and that has been our key. But I think looking to the future, that it will be organizations like, whether it's the League of Women Voters or whether it's the Arlington Education Association, or organizations that are based on interest groups, or opera, or arts, particularly I think the arts, that may be the strength of building our community going forward. I would just also add, I've read a lot of books about urban planning. One that I read a long time ago called Communitas by Paul and Percival Goodman, written in the 1930s, in my view, is the best book I've ever read on urban planning, urban concepts, and so on. And it covers all of the things that we've talked about tonight, about everything from resilience and having the ability for people to cope if they are confronted with a emergency and survival skills, to ways to build community, to plan a community, to build cohesion and so on. So I recommend that book particularly.
Yes. This has been a great discussion and a great presentation, and I find myself thinking all of these different new strange things coming about, but human nature doesn't change, or has it, might it, discuss.
Who wants to take that on?
Adrian. Come on, no, Adrian, it's clearly yours.
It's clearly your feeling. I think he needs a mic, though.
I'm trying to figure out where to start with that one. That is an.
You knew there'd be a price to pay for having done that deal with the county.
I know.
So here it is.
Here it is.
I am trying. I'm trying to figure out if we've seen a change in the way people approach things. And I'm, in. You know, I think it was interesting. As the three of us got up and spoke, we all spoke about things that were changing, and there was a lot of fixation on the technology. And it was great to have Mark come up at the end and talk. That a lot of it really hasn't changed. And so as I think about it, I'm going, there is a lot of change that's happening that is happening at lightning pace with regard to technology. But when you get down to the individual interactions, and we see it within the hospital, those haven't changed in the last 100 years. We still care about people. We still have feelings about people. Those pieces haven't changed. The way we interact has changed a little bit, but I don't think our hearts and our guts have changed with regard to how we feel about others and how we work with one another.
I've done a number of Delphi surveys, people making predictions about the future, and the one result that I found most interesting is that the one thing that people said would not change looking to the future is that people would always have clothes, wear clothes, because that defined status, and that status was the one thing that wouldn't ever change about human characteristics.
Let me add one more optimistic thought, which is the wonderful idea that history has a direction, and I believe that, and that the direction we've seen is the phrase used was the progressive expansion of the universe of moral objects. And the examples are, you go back to the founding of our country, African Americans were only 3/5 of a person. And now they're completely, women didn't get the right to vote till 1919. Children before 1900 were considered chattel. Jews weren't people in World War II, in Germany. Little by little, we have progressed and embraced.
Women are up to 72%, right?
Today, right? And animals, the whole, with the bill going through Congress this year on that will prohibit all cosmetic testing on animals, which is very different from 20 years ago when we would all be outraged by the Dreyfus test and this was just normal. So and whether that's a change in human nature or a change in the political structures that govern our lives, I'm not sure, but it's the right direction.
So I think we will.
One more question, and then we'll have wrap up from the panel.
I just want to tell you how beautiful the whole arts world is, the arts and humanities. Look at you, you're all technology and ahead, and we're thrilled to have been accepted as a member of the Federation. It has meant, it's like the best thing that's happened to me in 25 years of promoting the arts. So you think, and we're trying to catch up to where we Arlington ought to be with the arts, much less, look, it's running away from us. You know, I went last night to the Discovery School, and I thought it was awesome, but scared me. I can't shake it, because I think we're headed for getting rid of teachers. human teachers, excuse me, I mean regular old-fashioned teachers, it'll come because they think the pre-K kids can learn how to work the computer, that the whole building talks to you and teaches you. The whole thing is fantastic in what it's doing, but I kept thinking, okay, they have to have the children come, but maybe they won't with what you all are saying. It looks worse. But anyway, I think it matches your question. We kind of fit with the religion and that part of the humanity. And I think we are vitally needed. And if nothing else happens from having spoken here, if we can all kind of persuade people not to flinch when I say, I'm running an opera company. Then it would help me a lot if we could.
And we are looking for a cultural affairs chair. Yes,
I know, I'm looking too.
So gentlemen, maybe 45 seconds or a minute. What do you think the next 100 years or what you've changed your mind tonight about?
I'm still in the same place.
as the congressman said, I think that I'm just optimistic. I mean, the arc of history moves in a positive direction, and I think that this is a good place for people to look for that. So,
I'm looking forward to Victor writing a science fiction novel.
Something about human nature I wanted to mention. A number of years ago, I was a congressional staffer, and my job was to introduce the internet to Congress. And so I remember meeting with Sonny Montgomery from Mississippi, is an old congressman, had been there many, many years, and I told him about this. I said, so we're going to have the internet, and you're going to have an email address, and we'll be able to communicate with you. He looked at me and said, son, he said, I don't want that. He said, you know what's going to happen? You folks in technology are going to develop things so that people can live to 100 years old, but we don't have the food, the clothes, the environment to take care of them, and so we're going to have legislation in Congress that says, okay, you've reached 100 years old, we're shutting down the census, you're dead. Okay, so he said, so don't bother me about that. I don't want to hear it, son. And he was a character. If you had ever met him, he was a character. But I think what we're doing, we're all saying here, it's not that we can't deal with it. We just have to be aware that it's happening. Yeah. And we you folks are the key. And I said that in my speech that, I mean, this is the generation that figured out that the metro meant something. And you figured out how to do it. Affordable housing, you made it happen. And this isn't just another thing that's going to be a challenge that you can get by and achieve great things with. So I think that's the change.
Well, I'll end by stealing Mark's line and say that I think all of us were absolutely correct, and if you disagree, prove us in 100 years.
So to all of you, thank you. Wanted to say definitely thank you for coming out. And also, this is being recorded for Arlington Television, so other folks can watch it at a later date and time. So please encourage your neighbors, your colleagues, and your coworkers to take a look at what we talked about this evening. And hopefully the future will be so bright, we got to wear shades. Yeah. Thank you.
It's gonna be a self-driving ball. I know that one. Anyone can use that.